So what we're going to be doing now is we're going to be dealing with what is called integration by parts. And this is going to be fairly new. It looks a little awkward, so don't let this freak you out. It's actually it's very, very simplistic if we can get the motions on how to scaffold the problem and be prepared for it. But these are the types of problems when, up until this point, you've looked at it and U substitution has been used, or it's some basic antiderivative property, and then we get into a situation where those things no longer work. So what we need to do is we need to have a different tool so we can deal with the problem. So I'm going to write an example here. Right underneath this, I'm going to write an example as, what if we had the antiderivative of, we'll make it pretty simple here, just x e to the x dx. And what we have to get comfortable with is, you know, just can't use U substitution here. If we called something U, its derivative is not there. There's no way around this other than to think about this in terms of integration by parts. And if you noticed up here, there's something we need to call U. So it's still, in essence, thinking in terms of U. And then there's a part we want to call dv. So what we want to do is we want to think about what could U equal, and then what would dv equal? Okay? And just for note purposes, I'm going to be dealing with a column here, and in this column, I'm going to be taking derivatives. And whatever I'm going to be calling dv, I'm going to be taking antiderivatives. So it's important to think about this first, that whatever I call u, I need to be able to call it something that I can take its derivative of, because that's what I have to do here. And whatever I call dv, I have to have the capabilities of taking its antiderivative. So it's a good thought process to have first before we start assigning anything. So if we're looking at this problem, and we actually could take the derivative pretty easily of x, we could also take the derivative of e to the x. So it wouldn't really matter. So I'm just going to pick what would be the easiest to call u. So let's call this u. So u is going to be x. And this is the tricky part. See, if I call something u, everything else has to be the dv. I'm going to call this the dv. So if u is equal to x, dv over here has to equal e to the x dx. Don't forget to bring that down. It's everything else has got to be over here in the dv section, okay? So now let's take the derivative. Derivative of u is, as it has been, du. And the derivative of x is 1. And we can bring that dx over. So there's my derivative. Over here, again, I have to be thinking about antiderivatives. And you can see that the antiderivative, as a rule before, the antiderivative of dx was x. In this case, the antiderivative of dv is going to be v. Remember, that's just called the variable of integration. So v is going to equal, and I just need to take the antiderivative of e to the x. Again, that's a nice clean little rule, because it's just e to the x. And we don't have to put a plus cap c here. We don't have to put that. Okay, we don't have to do that in this particular instance until the very end. So now what I want to do is I want to scaffold this problem just to say, well, I've got a u I've got to throw in. Well, I have that. I have a v I have to throw in. I have that. And then I have minus the antiderivative of v. I still have a v. And the du, again, the du is right here. So I'm just going to put this in relationship to where it's supposed to go. So this is going to equal u, which is x, times v, which is e to the x, minus the antiderivative of v, which is e to the x, and du happens to be dx. Now I need to look at this problem, simplify anything that's necessary, and I have to do that. So I'm going to end up doing that right over here. So x times e to the x, well, that's just x e to the x minus the antiderivative of e to the x. Well, I already did that right there. I've already done that. And this is something that you'll see happens almost every time, is that you've already done this part of the problem when you were dealing with your dv. So the antiderivative of e to the x is e to the x. And now we can add r plus cap c. Of course, we could simplify that. You could take out an e to the x. I'm not going to. But there's the answer. There's the antiderivative of x e to the x based on integration by parts. So we're going to do another one, and we'll just do several until we feel comfortable with this. Okay? Let's take the antiderivative. Let's see what color I'm on here. Yellow. Let's take the antiderivative. I have another one prepared for this. X squared. Natural log of x dx. And again, we want to be thinking about the rule. So I'll just kind of slide the rule over here. But the rule says, if I have u dv, I can say it's u times v minus the antiderivative of v du. So I'm thinking about this problem as parts. What can I call u and what can I call dv? I have pieces of information. Now technically there's three pieces of information, but we're going to lump this into two pieces. Now remember what I said. When we come down here and we say, whatever I'm going to call u, I know I'm taking its derivative. That's what I'm going to have to do. And whatever I call dv, I have to take its antiderivative. Now this is a little tricky, because it would be really easy to grab the x squared and bring it down, because we could easily take its derivative. But then all of a sudden it would present an issue when we brought the natural log, because we do not have a rule for the antiderivative of the natural log. We get natural logs with anti-differentiation, but we're not taking the antiderivative of a natural log. So I don't want to call this u. I want to call that u, because this is what I can take the derivative of, and that is what I can take the antiderivative of. So in this case, I'm going to make sure I call that u. There's the natural log of x right there. And then what's left? Well, what's left is right here. That has to come over holistically over here. So I've called something u. Everything that was remainder was my dv. Now I can take the derivative. I can take the derivative of u and get du. And remember, I can take the derivative of a natural log. Well, that was 1 over x. So this becomes 1 over x dx. Now I can come over here and I can anti-differentiate. Antiderivative of dv is v. And the antiderivative of x squared is x cubed over 3. And again, I don't need to put the plus cap c because we'll do that at the very end. Okay, so let's follow this rule. It says right now I have the antiderivative of x squared, natural log of x, dx, and that's supposed to equal, according to the rule and the pieces I've generated, it's going to follow that formula. So it says it's going to follow u, which happens to be the natural log of x, times v, which is right here, x cubed over 3, minus the antiderivative of v, which is right here, du, which is right here. So there are things I'm going to have to do here. I can write this together. There's a couple things I'm going to do here, and I'm going to do this for the sake of space so I don't run out. But I can see that right now I have a 1/3 here that I can ultimately bring out, right? So if I take this 1/3 and I bring it out here, I can get rid of that. And think about now it's x cubed over 1. I could bring the 1/3 out. I have an x here that's going to cancel with one of these x's and make it x squared. So this problem was really minus 1/3 the antiderivative of just x squared. So I'm gonna erase that. And that's pretty much where we were at. So it was really asking us that. And like I said, notice that we've already done that. It's right here. We've already handled the antiderivative of x squared. So let's clean this up a little bit. And I'm gonna write this together as simply x cubed natural log of x over 3 minus, and this is 1/3 times the antiderivative of x squared, which was x cubed over 3, and there's your plus cap c. And then the only thing to do is, again, clean up anything that needs to be cleaned up, and this can be 1/9. So if I erase that, there is the antiderivative of this problem by using integration by parts. Okay, it is. It can be messy, right? I mean, we've got to stay organized here, and then jump to the rule and make sure that we're being very systematic. Okay, so there's two clean examples. I'll just add some more. I'm going to post this video first before I go and do any more. Okay, so if you have to rewatch these two examples, just so you can get comfortable of how I'm using this formula. Okay, we'll see you in a bit.